After making my review for The Neon Demon, I had an idea for a series where I delve into the world of arthouse cinema. From the time I was a senior in high school, I heard tall tales of David Lynch films and El Topo that confused me and turned me off from the whole adventure. Once I got into college, I started getting exposed to new films through classes and some film YouTube channels. Shout out to Red Letter Mia, by the way. Blue Velvet, 2001 A Space Odyssey, and The Witch come to mind as films that became instant favorites of mine. However, I was still cautious when it came to more obscure picks. So, in the spirit of experiencing new things, I hope to help you in introducing you to films that you may have never heard of and give you some insight as to why you should give them a chance. Or not. I have a feeling some of these may turn out to be crap, but hey, at least we try. So for today, in the first installment of An Adventure in Arthouse Cinema, we're going to talk about Rashomon. Rashomon is a Japanese film that was released in 1950. It was directed by highly acclaimed Japanese director Akira Kurosawa. For the uninitiated, Akira Kurosawa was one of the greatest directors of the postmodern era, making classics like Seven Samurai, Yojimbo, and Ran. He specialized in samurai films, with most films of his having a particular angle on the samurai's impact on his community and ethical dilemmas centered around samurais. Kurosawa is also referenced as the inspiration of many postmodern filmmakers, such as Stanley Kubrick, Martin Scorsese, and George Lucas especially. Rashomon is about the trial for a samurai who was found dead. The murderer is believed to be the famous bandit Tajomaru, played by Toshiro Mifune, but it is not that cut and dry. What makes the film special is in the inventive ways Kurosawa tells the stories of the accused. Once Tajomura tells his story, the samurai's widow, played by Machiko Kyo, comes up to give a completely different story, and it goes from there. Not only was this a very unique storytelling device at the time, showing multiple stories of the same event in a way that is still comprehensible, but it holds up as something I was intrigued in throughout my viewing of the film. We cannot talk about a Kurosawa film without talking about the technique. Kurosawa was in a class of his own when it came to framing and direction. The shot variety alone is impressive, but Kurosawa goes the extra mile by filming to enhance the story. Oftentimes, I find myself being able to understand what is happening in the story through the visuals alone. To me, that is the mark of a good filmmaker. Kurosawa understands mise-en-scene in a way that seems so simple yet so rich in story. One example in particular is using the camera in the trial scenes as a barrier between the person speaking and the jury, in quotes. I say jury, in quotes, because the camera is framed so that the characters are explaining their cases and talking to us, the audience, as if we are the authority on this case. Rainfall, broken down buildings, men tied up, these things work as framing devices for the characters to live in and the story to breathe through them. The performances of Mifune and Kyo stand out as being both engaging and a bit cringy at times. Whether it is Mifune's over-the-top antics or Kyo's submissive nature, it can get a bit odd at times, but ultimately, you are along for the ride. Dialogue is executed very well, with no real problems in the translation of Japanese to English subtitles. The black and white look does not worsen the quality of the film. Everything is executed extremely well. Then, what's the problem, if there even is one? The problem ultimately comes down to the progression of the story and pacing. While you do have exciting moments and interactions throughout the film, Act 1 can be a drag if you are not into the performances of the actors. Unfortunately, I found myself having a difficult time maintaining focus in some of the heavy dialogue scenes. It may be an age issue or a conflict in comparing this with modern film pacing, but I disagree. Other films like Citizen Kane and The Best Days of Our Lives stand out as films of that era that keep me engaged, much like a modern film. In closing though, I would still recommend that you check out Rashomon. On a pure technical level, it is interesting to watch and see how modern film directors get inspired by Kurosawa's work. The story is compelling enough that can keep you invested. Just don't have a pillow by your side, because that's a battle that could be tough to win, specifically in Act 1. I'll be back in a couple weeks with the other installment of An Adventure in Arthouse Cinema. So see you guys later.